This paper, called Deform with Constant Discrete Gaussian Curvature, proposes, in a first step, to extend the notions of mean and Gaussian curvatures of smooth and discrete surfaces to semi-discrete surfaces. The sphere and the platonic polyhedra are geometric figures with constant Gaussian curvature for smooth and discrete geometry. In a second step, we investigate which equivalents have the same property for the semi-discrete geometry. Without pretending to describe them exhaustively, we show some specimens among D-forms. Some of them exhibit several symmetries, and unexpectedly, some others have cutting patterns with little regularity. Halfway between smooth and discrete, semi-discrete geometry consisting of a patching of developable surfaces has been widely explored, in particular for constructive reasons. Its property of being isometric to the Euclidean plane makes it particularly relevant for forming complex facade panels from standard flat elements, usually sold in sheets or coils. In the academic and scientific fields, the seams between surfaces have received attention, particularly through curved folding process. The paper Folding Developables by Duncan and Duncan uses notions of smooth differential geometry to describe the kinematic coupling between the two folded surfaces. Killian et al., on the other hand, rely on discrete differential geometry. Curved folding has been implemented at several scales, from artistic works to architecture and industrial design. But in this paper, we propose to focus on curved patching, which is a more general type of assembly of developable surfaces than curved folding. The first one assembles two surfaces sharing the same unrolled edge, while in the second case, the edges have different geometries while keeping identical length. In a sense, curved folding is a developable mechanism, since it can be completely unfolded. On the contrary, curved patching is still a mechanism, but can no longer be totally unfolded. This is a good indication of the existence of Gaussian curvature in the edge. We have experimented with this type of assembly in a full-scale prototype where the shear modules are made of piecewise developable surfaces. A better understanding of the distribution of the Gaussian curvature in the seams has motivated the following study. For the following, we adopt, for the elements of the piecewise developable surfaces, a terminology analogous to that of the polyhedral surfaces. A face is defined as a single smooth developable surface. An edge is defined as the intersection of two faces. A vertex is defined as the intersection of at least three edges. We will now try to answer the question, how to evaluate the Gaussian curvature at the seams of a piecewise developable surface. Without going into the details of the demonstration, we give here the main points. This definition is based on Steiner's formula, which links the measure, the offset value, and the total curvature of a manifold. In the simple case of a curve, there is a linear relationship between length variation of the offsetted curve, in red on the picture, and total curvature of the original one, in black. In the case of a surface, the area of the normal shift is a quadratic polynomial involving total Gaussian and mean curvature. This formula was already used by Bob and Co. to establish that Gaussian and mean curvatures are contained within different geometric entities for polyhedral surfaces. Gaussian curvature is localized in the vertices, whereas mean curvature is localized in the edges. The faces have no curvature. In our case, and in an analogous way, It is enough to observe the nature of the area variation at the vertices and edges to establish the value of Gaussian and mean curvature. The result of particular interest here is that the Gaussian curvature at a given point on the seam can be defined as the sum of the geodesic curvature of the adjacent faces at the same point. We illustrate the previous result by varying the point P along the seam. Each face, by its geodesic curvature, contributes to the Gaussian curvature. The values of geodesic curvatures of left surface in blue and right surface in red are plotted on the graph to give the Gaussian curvature. In our example, the angle of the seam is always oriented downwards. Intuitively, the Gaussian curvature is positive when the osculating circle of the seam is oriented in the same direction and negative otherwise. As said before, we use a particular class of surfaces for the investigation of semi-discrete shapes with constant Gaussian curvature, the D-forms. The D-forms are composed of two topological disks of equal perimeters. These two disks can be identical or of different shapes. The two parameters are then associated from two initial points. The result is different for each pair of initial points. In the general case, D-forms are closed piecewise developable surfaces with no boundary or vertex. Since it is homeomorphic to a sphere, the Gauss-Bonnet formula is written. 4 pi equals integral of Gaussian curvature or integral of the sum of the geodesic curvatures. Thanks to these geometrical and topological definitions, we are now equipped to investigate D-forms with constant Gaussian curvature and, in a first time, the one with symmetrical cutting patterns. A trivial case meets immediately the constraints outlined just before. It is a D-form made of two identical cutting patterns, a kind of developable tennis ball. With the arc facing the line segment, the Gaussian curvature is of course constant. This type of cutting pattern, with only two distinct radii of curvature, can be generalized as a two-parameter family. The two identical cutting patterns to be assembled are defined by a first discrete parameter n. It characterizes the symmetry group to which the cutting patterns belong. We can say more simply the number of branches. Each cutting pattern thus consists of two n arcs, but only two are different. Let's call them A alpha and A beta. For the assembly, A alpha corresponds to A beta. The D-form is therefore a constant Gaussian curvature surface since A alpha and A beta have constant geodesic curvature. The second parameter, in addition to n, is alpha, which is the opening angle of the arc A alpha. The angle beta is not a free parameter and is defined by the Gauss-Bonnet relation. This animation illustrates the influence of the two parameters on the shape of the cutting pattern. The modeling of isometric deformation of flat shapes into three-dimensional surfaces is not a trivial exercise. But in our case, the symmetry conditions of the cutting patterns give us the possibility to find a closed-form solution for the geometry of the three-dimensional shape from its two cutting patterns. We now investigate D-forms, still with a constant Gaussian curvature, but this time with dissymmetric cutting patterns. As before, we keep working with piecewise circular curves. Let C1 be the boundary curve of the first cutting pattern. It consists of n tangent arcs of circle A1i defined by the three coupled parameters alpha1i, r1i and l1i. Once the first cutting pattern is chosen, C2, the second pattern, is then completely defined since the length of the arcs must be identical 2 by 2 to be assembled, and the radii of curvature are linked by the constant Gaussian curvature constraint. In the general case, the concatenation of the computed arcs of the second cutting pattern yields an open curve. By applying the closure conditions outlined in the paper, it is possible to close them by constraint optimization. But to go further and explore a whole family of solutions, the idea is now to apply a geometric flow to this initial solution. This flow should satisfy, over time, both the constant Gaussian curvature constraint and the closure conditions of the two cutting patterns. This flow is isoperimetric and is applied to the polygonal evolute of the curve of the first cutting pattern. In this way, the evolute acts as a closed rigid bar linkage whose joints are the centers of discs that roll on each other. The curve supported by these discs remains closed regardless of the deformation of this mechanism. However, the isometric flow applied to the evolute of the first curve do not ensure the closure of the second one. It is therefore necessary to increase the constraints of the isometric flow by integrating the closure conditions of the second curve. The details of that process are described in the article. Finally, we show here the implementation of this augmented isoperimetric flow. It exhibits the evolution over time of the two cutting patterns of a family of dissymmetric D forms with constant Gaussian curvature. These works are part of the PhD thesis Building with Developable Surfaces conducted in the Navier and Lama laboratories. This thesis is a result of the collaboration and the funding of TESS, Engineering Office, and VIRI, Steel Contractor. Two pavilions from this thesis are on virtual exhibition and visible on the ThinkShell website. Thank you for your attention.